But if your body's not actually eliminating, it won't mean anything because it's just going to cycle back into your system. That. So if you're now trying to clean that mess up, you'll have to kind of dump everything out, which will make it for your system. Like, what the, where did this all come from? And from a nervous network, right? We're stimulating the nervous system. So we're drawing attention to those areas as well. So.
Okay, so I'd like to introduce Dr. James Truong. He is of the Alberta Health Institute. Dr. James is joining us to share with us the difference between detox cleansing and drainage and why it's so important for us. Also learn about these processes are stuck or not working and how that can affect the rest of the body, namely the nervous system. Dr. James spoke previously to the CNA in May of 2021 on naturopathic medicine, and you can view on our website that talk. Dr. James is a naturopathic doctor here in Calgary, Alberta. He graduated from the University of Calgary in 2005 with a biological science degree with a minor in psychology. He then moved on to the Canadian College of Naturopathic Medicine, where he graduated in 2009. And has been practicing since then. Dr. James sat on the board of College of Naturopathic Doctors as the complaints chair from 2011 to 2015, and currently sits as a member of the hearing tribunal. He has helped people with fatigue, pain, hormone imbalances, and of course, neuropathy. He utilizes an assortment of alternative modalities in his treatments to provide the best care to his patients. Thanks.
Thank you, Linda, for that introduction. So without further ado, we'll get started. So this one topic is one that we discuss with patients all the time. So what does detoxing, cleansing, drainage have to do with our nervous system? It's a pretty important topic as it really relates to the entire body and how our body really, really functions. So I thought it was an important topic because it is the starting point for anything we do with neuropathy or any other conditions that apply. So first things first, I wanted to kind of quickly discuss what disease is in itself. So by definition, disease is a disorder of structure or function in a human, animal, or plant, especially one that produces signs and symptoms that affect a specific location, but not simply a direct result of physical energy. Another way to think of this is actually just disease, dis-ease of the body. So the body is just not easy with itself and not in homeostasis. So the question is, what is homeostasis? Homeostasis in itself is just a tendency for the body to stay in an equilibrium in the body, which is maintained by physiological processes. So basically, your body will like to keep itself as stable as possible until something pushes it over the edge. So why is that important? As just mentioned, the body will try all the time to keep things as stable as possible to the point where that's it. I can't handle anymore, and then all of a sudden you see these conditions, these ailments that occur, symptoms that kind of tell you to go see your doctor or whatever your medical professional. So how do we keep things happy with your body? So these are the things that we do as doctors or in general. We detox, we drain, and cleanse. These terms have been used interchangeably. There are minor differences between them. So we will quickly go through those differences. So a detox in itself is actually just the body's ability to neutralize any oxidants, toxins in the body. We have different methods of doing that, meaning though we've heard of a lot of is antioxidants, right? Which we can take from an external source, but your body has its own antioxidants that it can produce itself, very well designed. Drainage is in itself also just how the body eliminates. So a lot of people will confuse the two with detoxing and then finally cleansing, which we'll chat about shortly here. Drainage is actually that elimination process, right? So detox is not eliminating, So you may neutralize things, but things may get stuck. And that bad final one there, cleansing, is just a process in which it incorporates both the detoxing and the drainage. So cellular restoration, basically, these are the functions on that left side there. As you can see, it's just how our system works, right? So these are things that every day your body does without thinking, right? So respiratory, so your breathing, your immune system, keeping your body protected, the ability to speak, digestion, cleaning out your liver, filtering out stuff by your liver, filtering stuff out by your kidneys, brain, lungs, your heartbeat, those kinds of things. Those are everyday processes your body not think about and just does daily all the time. But these processes metabolize and produce waste. And so that in itself is already a lot for your body to handle, right? So now we add extra things, the external environment, so chemicals that we're exposed to day in, day out. This stat, it's actually quite a bunch of Canadian stats on toxins. So this one came from the Neuropathy Center in the discussion. So yes, I'm in well important.
Thanks.
So mainly, exposed to 700,000 different chemicals per day, which is a lot of chemicals, and it's a lot for your body to deal with. Last number I heard actually from the Global Healing Center, it can go up to 2.1 million chemicals that we're exposed to daily. So again, that can come from your cleaning materials, perfumes, colognes, air fresheners, plastic bottles. These are things we are really, really exposed to day in, day out, and your body has to deal with it and cleaning it out. So, which organs are mainly responsible for the filtering process? Which organs are responsible for cleaning these toxins out of the body? We very much know the liver. We've heard that time and time again. However, there is still your kidneys and there is your lungs as well. Those are the big three, which is what we normally see. Next one. So we'll go through each one. The liver, the big one that we all know about, and the one that we always hear about. There's two phases that your liver go through to detox. So there's the phase one, which is the enzymes that break it down, these toxins, and then make it more water soluble. The catch with phase one is the byproduct of it causes some oxidants in our body. So it is, if you leave it long-term, it can cause a little bit more damage. This is sometimes when people do liver detoxes on their own, they feel horrible. They don't feel so good. The term is healing crisis. And the reason for that is because these toxins are now floating in the system, which then leads to phase two, which is the actual elimination of those toxins. Sometimes from genetics and stuff like that, phase two can be slower than phase one. So you may be eliminating slower with that. So then you have this accumulation of oxidants, but your body does have ways to mediate that with the antioxidant it can produce. But we do have supplements that we can use, but on the right there, there are a couple of vitamins that we use to help neutralize that. The biggest one there is the glutathione. The glutathione is the biggest one for antioxidants. It's the main one for the body that we use. It can be produced by liver, but we also can take it from an external standpoint. Phase two in itself, the biggest one there generally actually is sulfur. Sulfur binds to things really, really well. Not that I'm telling people to see a whole bunch of sulfur, but there's ways that we get sulfur from our foods, and we'll discuss that.
Sure.
Next one, kidneys. So the kidneys themselves, they filter blood, and then obviously we eliminate their urine. Doesn't have as many phases as the liver, but still very, very important, right? Because then it helps with the water-soluble side of things. So any toxins that are on the water-soluble that dissolve a lot easily in water is easier to eliminate. So you're just essentially urinating it out. And so that process on the right in the net line is kind of how the filtering system goes. So that long enough there, that's where everything gets eliminated, and then your blood gets clean, and then recycled. This is where actually some parts of blood pressure come into play. So if there's clogged kidneys, your blood pressure might go up because there is that fat, but we'll be discussing that shortly. The lungs. So this one we do forget. This is one that people really, really don't think about, and it's actually quite important. We've noticed that air is quite important, right? Oxygen is pretty important. We don't go very long without it. And it's the first area that we get exposed to in the external environment, right? So you think about car exhaust, you think of pollution itself, but even just oxygen itself, right? If your lungs are not working properly, how well are you breathing? How well are you functioning? How well are you thinking, right? And so the lungs is definitely one that gets missed the most, but very, very important. So there's a discussion about skin, and skin's actually the fat, right? Skin is the largest organ of our body. So it's actually not one of our primary methods of detoxing. It does protect us, don't get me wrong, but it is not, it's the secondary one, mainly because it is the largest organ. And so we're using it as our vascular system. So if the skin is in trouble, then we're even in more trouble than before. But generally, the body is pretty smart, so it's used the largest organ at the back of the system to eliminate toxins and environments. This is where people will get the eczema, the psoriasis, the acne, those kinds of things. Those are all signs that probably one of the first three is blocked and compromised. And so it's now using the skin to help clear the toxicity. So how does this relate to my nervous system? Part of that, why I have to go through the four stages of disease. I don't know how many of you have ever heard this before. I've done it in previous talks, but I'm not sure if I did it in the last talk. I don't think I did, so I want to make sure we got this covered. So four stages is listed there. We'll go one by one. So first stage is the elimination stage. Second stage is the inflammation stage. Third stage is the deposition, and lastly is impregnation, and we'll go through why those things are important. So the first stage is pretty simple, elimination. The first thing you think about when you get food poisoning, what happens, right? Your body will want to expel it as quickly as possible, right? So whether you're running to the washroom, whether you're vomiting, diarrhea, those kinds of things, your body wants it out as fast as possible. If it's not in your body, then it can't cause any, right? So that's the first stage. The second stage is the inflammation stage. So this is the stage that most of us feel. This is where the pain, discomfort comes about. Mainly the best way to think about it is when we get colds and flus, right? So it is the very first symptom that we get in cold and flu. Most of it is, or should be, fever, right? Or that fever that we normally get that tells us, oh yeah, by the way, you are not feeling well. There is something invading your body. We need to get rid of it, kill it, and then dispel. So then the second half of that is the coughing, the sneezing, the mucus buildup that's in your system that is now coming out, right? So as you already seen in itself, we have to go through the different stages to get rid of disease and completion, right? So, if your body can't fight it and you can't get rid of it right away, what's the next step for your body? And this is where how this is starting to relate to your nervous system. So, your body, if it can't get rid of it right away and can't reorganize anything, it will tuck it away somewhere, right? It will put it somewhere that it's not going to be harmful to the body or minimize the harmfulness. And then when the body has enough energy to clear it, clean it out, then it will do all the steps that it needs to. So it will create the inflammation stage and then the elimination stage, right? So where this gentleman here, where he doesn't have time to clean up his room properly, he's just gonna tuck away, hide it. And so tucking it away, hiding it until it has time to eliminate, and then, to get to the inflammation stage, kill it, and then get rid of it, okay? Now, this is where, again, if your filtering systems are not working, then now your body's gonna deposit. Now, where do you think it's going to deposit first? So mainly, we see it quite often, is it actually will, you think about what the least vital areas of your body are. So realistically, that is your fats, your muscles, and your joints, right? You do not want it in your organs, you do not want it in your heart, you don't want it in your brain, those kinds of things. So that's where it's going to go. Nervous system will also fall under that category behind that. Now, saying that too, there are certain toxins that will attract to the nervous system a little bit easier than others. So in my previous discussion of heavy metals will go to the nervous system because it's just likes that better. Sometimes, or certain time. And so the last stage, which is a further stage of this, which so this stage is the deposition stage, the final stage would be the impregnation stage. So if the toxin is in your system for too long, it too will metabolize, it too will break down, it too will produce its own toxins as it stays in your system. And that's when we really, really see the chronic conditions in our body. So this is where most times we are seeing cancer, the autoimmune disorder, any really, really chronic conditions will be in the stage and causing that damage that has now confused your body. So the body thinks it's part of it. So as mentioned before, you have to, in order to get the disease completely, you have to go through all these different stages and then out. Okay. So again, how does that relate to my nervous system? As mentioned, when the filtering systems are all clogged up and that back occurs, those toxins have to go somewhere, right? Laws of physics still apply. And so if there is something there, it will deposit into its back, mainly nerve, joints, muscles, but it can go to your nervous system, right? And then that can cause neuropathy. Especially peripheral, right? That'd be the first because it's the first away versus going to the vital areas of the system. So as discussed, what happens when your filtering systems are backed up? Over time, our filtering systems do get clogged, they build up toxins in the body, and it has just nowhere else to go. And so it goes back into our tissues and then causes health concerns in that sense. So, as mentioned, the detoxification phases, the liver in itself, we're going to focus on the liver a little bit more just because it is the most well-known, and most of the antioxidants are being produced from the liver, okay? And then, like I said, the glutathione is the biggest one that our body produces, but there are ways to mediate that better, as well as our foods if you're eating a lot of them. Berries and vitamin foods that have a lot of vitamin C's, your vegetables, you are going to get those antioxidants in, and it will just help neutralize those toxins, whether it's from your actual phase one toxin or from environmental toxins, will help neutralize that. So give me time for the phase two of your liver to eliminate that out of your system and into the bowels. Okay. Some of the ones that are very, very helpful. So the B vitamins that are listed there are actually more supportive. They're actually supporting the liver to do the work, not necessarily antioxidant. Okay? As we know as well, B vitamins help your nervous system, right? So you're going to get a lot of benefit that way. So mention the branch amino acid, one of the biggest ones is N-acetylcysteine, which is shorthanded for NAC. And that the reason why that one is because it really helps with the glutathione production. It is the precursor. So it is the building block necessary for glutathione to stay in your system a little bit better. Flavonoids would be, again, from fruits. And the phospholipids is actually more what your cell membranes are made of are from phospholipids. So again, it just helps with turnover of cells that might be just too contaminated, I guess is the best way to say it. With toxins, and it just helps flip those cells so your body can get rid of it. Things that you take externally, the vitamin C at the bottom corner, vitamin E, vitamin A. You have to be careful with vitamin A for sure. It's very easy to overload the liver as it is. Vitamin A, if you take too much, can damage the liver, so you're going to want to be careful with that. Selenium is a big one. Both you can use. And then there's certain herbs which we will discuss in there. The phase two, as I mentioned, sulfur is the biggest one. We do talk about methylation. That's been a nice word that's been coming up a lot lately. And then again, that just helps bind the toxin and then help with the elimination of that out of the body. And so phase two is really, really just about getting the junk out of your body. So drainage. So again, is your body properly eliminated? And it's one of those things where I do ask my patients this a lot. And the reason being is in this phase here, in the detox phase, I live in the phase two where it's focusing on elimination. You can detox, but if your body is not actually eliminating, it won't mean anything because it's just going to cycle back into your system, right? Because you're not getting it out. You're not getting into the external environment. And so what happens is then your body recycles that into back into your tissues. So your body can be detoxing perfectly fine, but because you're not getting it rid of it, you're just recycling the toxin and it's causing just much damage. You're not feeling well. So it's very, very important if you need to be eliminating properly, right? So making sure you're having balance every day. Hopefully you're eating every day. But we do come into cases that that's not always the case.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Yes.
I read somewhere just yesterday that toxins can then get stored in fat cells. So if you start to lose weight, then you're going to be releasing all those again. Correct. That's true, hey?
That is very true. And that's why in weight losses where people are like, well, I've done all these things, I've done my calories, I'm eating all this pop food, and they can't get rid of it. And it's because, again, these filtering systems are not working properly and they're clogged. So the toxins are keeping it at bay. And then what's happening is as you consume water, which is also, are you drinking enough water? One. And two, if you're not drinking enough, your body will retain it. So it's like making that super strong tea or coffee. And you're like, whoa, this is just too much. And so you're adding water. So then in that sense, your body's retaining that water just to neutralize the toxicity that is in your system. A lot of people who do lose weight, some a good share of it's just water. It's been retained because of the toxins that are in the fat cells. But that also, the concern there also lies, and this is why the antioxidants are so important. When you start doing that, when you start losing weight and the fats start eliminating these toxins in your system, neutralizing that, right? So you're not feeling off because people can't. They don't feel horrific because the toxins are just like, how they come in.
And that's what this was saying, was that a lot of people give up because they start feeling so bad.
Yeah.
And it's partially because of these toxins that are
dripping. So that's when, we will be discussing little treatments to, little methods to help kind of help clear that up in very, very important stuff. And then inclusion is obviously that combination of the two, right? So as much as semantics, it was related to just semantics, the cleansing is that making sure that you are detoxing as well as you can, and then making sure you're eliminating and draining out as much as you can. That way you are cleansing your body properly.
Okay. I have a couple of people have said your voice is hard to hear clearly. I'm not sure why. I don't know. Yeah, let's try that. And you can slow back down again. And then a question on, have you had any successes with Lyme disease?
Lyme disease. So we do have some patients who have Lyme. It's a lot of work. It's not easy and it's not a quick fix. But we do have methods to help with treatment with Lyme. This is one of it. There's others that we have to really, really be looking at.
Is that the
tics? Lyme disease is from the tics.
Horrible disease and people with it.
Yeah, it's very draining. So when your body doesn't have enough energy to fight, is one of the issues too. And with the virus, with the bug in itself and how fast it grows, it learns to adapt pretty quickly. So your body has to adapt almost with it. Or your immune system has to adapt pretty quickly.
Right.
Yeah. And is that better when it comes to sound?
Somebody let me know if that's better. if you're hearing the sound, but oh, wait a minute. Somebody let me know if you're hearing the sound better now, please.
Some just common methods used to help clean our filters. So the first one, which we kind of just discussed, is the hydration. Herbs is a big common one, right? You see these in the markets, herbal formulas, teas, those kinds of things. Nutrients, which we kind of went through a little bit already. Homeopathics that I use, which we'll discuss, and then acupuncture. There are other methods, but we will go through. These are the main ones we use. So first thing is hydration, right? Making sure, are you drinking enough water? So the biggest thing for me is making sure that it's filtered, right? Powdered water, even though one of the cleanest, still a lot of chemicals in it. And so you do want to make sure that that water is filtered. I mean, you can see the scaling of just calcium on the sides, right? So that just shows that in itself. You don't want that scaling in your system either, in your body. So that's part of it. There is a method to the madness of water. If you are, my concern is always, if you're not drinking a lot already, don't jump up to the amount that you need to drink, right? So rule of thumb for water is half your weight in ounces is how much water you should be consuming. Now, saying that, if you are drinking only one glass of water per day, please do not jump up to probably the 2 liters, if not 3 liters, that you have per day. That will damage your kidneys. 100% it will. Not only that, you'll be in the washroom all day long. Like, I'm done with this. I am not drinking water because I'll be in the washroom all day long. So like anything else, you need to train your body. So if you are drinking only one glass, I would ask that you only drink 1.5 to 2 glasses the next essentially week to 10 days. Just let your body get used to it. And bit by bit, your body will get used to that amount of water, and then you can increase again. Just because, yeah, you really, really need to make sure your kidneys are cracked for the amount of water that you are going to be drinking. Lemon water, I did add lemon water in there. It is one that we've heard a lot about. It does. It's a nice little gentle cleanse for your liver. You do need to take a break once in a while. And it is the slice, it's the rind that's actually the more important part. So I do ask slice this lemon. Do not just use 5 juice of lemon, okay, and then squeeze that in. That's not the same. The rind needs to be part of the equation there.
I think we've all been doing it wrong all along.
The juice will apply water, don't get me wrong, but it's not the liver component of it. And it does have to be lemon, not lime. Lime won't do the same trick. The other reason is, yes, you would want to take breaks once in a while because before it gets metabolized, it's still an acid. So you want to make sure you don't want to ruin your teeth, your enamel. We don't want to add a heavy dental bill at the end of the day either.
So since it's the rind, not the juice, do you have to let it soak for quite a while before it's, no,
it doesn't take long at all. Especially because if you're drinking 1 or 2 glasses, you'll just refill the glass with the slices that are already in there. So it won't take long at all. So that's not necessary. Yeah. The nutrients to help the detox, draining, cleanse. So I do list them out. So yeah, the biggest one, like I said, the glutathione. The B vitamins will help with that support, right, of the liver. It doesn't really do any detox. B6 can, but mainly they're just doing the support. Vitamin A, and the antioxidant part of it, selenium. CoQ10 has been getting a lot of information lately, and it helps not only the liver, and it's not only a really strong antioxidant, but it does support heart health. There's been a lot of discussion on heart health with it, but also energy. Actually, it's part of sort of the cellular respiration chain that helps produce energy. So quite a key part in that. Alpha lipoic acid, a bit strong antioxidant snap that I discussed as the precursor of glutathione. Zinc, especially at this time.
Before you go on, sorry. I have two questions.
Yeah.
Michelle is asking, she says her medications dry her system out, so she drinks a ton of water. Can she drink too much?
You'll know if you drink too much if you're going a lot more frequently. And you can drink too much, but it depends on the speed in which you drink it and the amount of volume. Again, if you do, if you're only drinking that 1 liter and now you've jumped up to 3 liters and you didn't give your body enough time to strengthen, to exercise that out, you can definitely cause damage to your kidneys for sure.
Okay. And then someone else was asking about carbonated water and then the microplastics toxins, they're especially harmful in bottles, let's say plastic pitchers and stuff like that.
Right. So yeah, so we did mention the plastic bottles before, and yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. The danger of carbonated water, it can eat away at the plastics, right? And react with the plastics as the aluminum cans. Concerned as aluminum cans as well, because not knowing how long the water's been in those cans as well, that can cause effect, same thing as the plastic bottles, they'll just leach into the system. So that's why making sure you're detoxing, cleaning, and doing a drainage part of things is going to be helpful. Carbonated water is interesting because carbonated water is actually acidic in nature. So it will slow down the process of detoxing because you're adding an acidic environment to your system. If that's the only way you're going to get water in, then I would say then yeah. But if you can do flat or a mixture of both, then that's still better, right? So it's a relative thing.
Okay, and we had another one come in. Can too much water affect glaucoma pressure?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Because your body will retain the water as it needs to. That's where you'd have to talk to a healthcare professional, depending on what cases, to see what the right amount of water is for you. Yeah. When I said the half a weighted ounce, that's a general kind of overall health thing. All right. So the zinc is where we left off. The zinc in itself, really good for this season. As we're heading into winter season, it's a really good immune booster. So then you definitely would want some of that in your system, as well as a good antioxidant. Vitamin E, that we've known for a long time as well. And the sulfur, as mentioned, again, do not just randomly take sulfur. There are things there that will help. First. So one of the first ones, is the milk thistle. I think a lot of us have heard about milk thistle. So milk thistle is interesting. It's actually a hepatoprotective, so it means it protects the liver. There's minor detoxing properties in it, actually. But there is some. But mainly it does protect the liver. Dandelion roots, so yes, the ones that do grow outside. Really nice little yellow flowers there. I do not recommend that you pick the ones that are outside, as they're very polluted. But yes, the dandelion, there's teas out there. The root will help the liver. The leaf will help the kidneys. Now, there is a caution with that, as with most of the herbs that we use. The leaf can disrupt potassium levels in the system, right? So very much like a water buildup. You just need to make sure your potassium is not thrown off a little bit. Globe artichoke, if you boil that will help kind of clean the liver and the kidneys. Not well known, chrysanthemum flowers. So there's chrysanthemum teas out there that will help with the liver, as well as just cholesterol. So fat food, it'll help. So you're eating greasy foods, that will help break that up a little bit better. Cleavers are actually mainly for the lungs. As mentioned, we forget about the lungs quite a bit. As it's hopeful, but we make sure that those are in there as well. If you're feeling a little bit of breathing issues, congestion, asthma, those kind of things, now that it's fall season, which needs your medicine is a long time, you want to make sure that that's strong.
Homeopaths. So I mentioned, this is one of the biggest ones that I use in my practice. It is the complex homeopathics lead for drainage and detoxing. So it's usually, it's a combination of different herbs, minerals to help with the drainage and cleansing of your body. Complex remedies. There are single homeopathics that we use. The world has come a little bit more complicated and more complex. So I find that the complex remedies are a little bit better. Single remedies are more for certain cases and specificity. But yes, the complex remedies are what I use mainly. Knowing that though, there are potential side effects. And so again, that healing crisis that some people may have heard of, that may come about because we may be cleaning the body a little bit more aggressive. So we have to caution. It's like that one GIF that I showed where the person was hiding all that stuff. It's no different than that. So if you're now trying to clean that mess up, you'll have to kind of dump everything out, which will make it for your system. Like, what the, where did this all come from? And then reorganize it, right? And so sometimes with complex homeopathics, they will lead to feeling awful. I do want my patients that that might be the case. And so we have to dose accordingly for that.
Before you go on, we had another, never had so many questions about water. We've read recently, drinking a lot of water without adding electrolytes will weaken the electrolytes in the body and take up your energy. Is that true?
There was concern about that. I don't know if it weakens the electrolytes in your body, because bodies will try to maintain that a lot better.
Probably, maybe dilute would be the better
choice. It shouldn't dilute it either, because body will, there's mechanisms in your body that will help with that dilution and making sure that the electrolytes are in order. Can it do it? Have I seen it? This last summer was actually a really interesting summer because it was so hot in Calgary, and something that we're not used to by any means. So everyone was very much losing their electrolytes. So most of the water that I was recommending there, I was still recommending that they had some electrolytes with their water at that time, because everyone was running dehydrated and it was not, they weren't absorbing a lot of
water. Okay, that said, the only things I know that have electrolytes are like Gatorade, which is packed with sugar and its equivalent, and Pedialyte. Are there other ways to do that? Or?
Yeah, so we came up with a formula for sugar for it that I was doing a long time ago. Pedialyte is one that I do recommend. Noon tablets as well.
Noon?
N-U-U-N.
Okay.
That's another one that you can use. Those were the ones that I did recommend. I know it was funny, one of my patients actually brought up that there's a Pedialyte Breezy that came out over the summer. So it was a nice way for people that they needed to cool down a little bit faster. They had the opportunity to do so. So, but that was a concern this summer for sure, that electrolytes was running low for people. Yeah. But yeah, the body does have mechanisms to make sure that electrolytes won't be diving too much in that sense. Yeah. Want to move on?
No. No. Not right now. As soon as you start, there's always a new one.
Acupuncture. In general. So acupuncture, we're strengthening those organs, right? We're strengthening the lungs, we're strengthening up the liver. What it is, and it's bringing up the kidneys, depending on what we find is the weak point, and just helping move things, right? We're helping with the circulation and get things out of the system, and making the body stronger. Now, there is caveats with that. If your system is not strong enough, we have to be careful a little bit with the acupuncture, how many points we're using, because that can beat you as well. So, but we generally are looking at supporting the organs responsible for cleaning up the system and from a nervous standpoint, right? We're stimulating the nervous system. So we're drawing attention to those areas as well. So you can do a 2-for-1, right? You can get treatments to help with cleansing, detoxing, but also helping repair nerves and dealing with that scenario. So
it does on two levels then,
yeah.
Because it's stimulating the nerves, like you said, and then it's also cleaning out the toxins that are going to impact the nerves and cause more damage.
Correct. And strengthen up the organs responsible for helping build them.
Do all that. Yeah.
Yeah. Super, super important. These are things that we eat day in, day out, and feed our body. So fiber, you got to make sure you're getting your fiber in, because you got to make sure you're eliminating, right? So making sure that is, the recommendation is 25 to 30 grams of fiber per day in general. Again, that's general, not for everyone. So you're making sure that you are having those bowel movements, cleaning out your body of those toxins so they're not in your system. However, these are some of the foods that are helping with the detox thing. So phase one, beets, broccoli, brown rice, carrots, garlic, paya, beans. Phase two, as you can see, there is some overlap. So broccoli, cabbage, dill nuts, garlic, onions, asparagus, papaya. Okay. The reason why broccoli is in both, one, because it has a lot of the nutrients that had for antioxidant purposes, but it's also a sulfur-containing vegetable, as is your garlic, your onions, your cauliflower, so anything, Brussels sprouts. So anything part of the grass-fed species will help with that phase two and that elimination of things.
Mm-hmm.
Asparagus, more actually kidneys, not necessarily.
Papaya
will help just because it helps. It has a lot of fiber, but it'll help on the intestines.
Oh,
yeah.
Hang on.
For papaya, is it any different to have the dried kind that you often see? You can buy the...
Like the dried fruit?
Dried fruit as opposed to fresh fruit?
You would want more fresh than dry. The reason is the dry fruit tends to have a little bit more sugar to it. And depending on what they use to preserve it. So the concern is the preservatives that might be in there may hinder the actual effect of the papaya. So yeah, more the fresher the better. It's the idea. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so these are some of the extra stuff. So these are the things that I did not, and in fact, I added last minute for the presentation. But things that are actually very, very important to helping with the detoxifications, extra things we can do that not necessarily need to consume. So the first one is alternating hot and cold showers. It increases circulation. There's a look of concern. what it does help move the lymphatics. So we did not talk about the lymphatic system, which is a pretty important system, actually. The lymphatic carries the fat and waste products out of your body as well. And so that helps move that. The alternating hot and cold showers will help with that. Figure out. But again, you're going to get a lot of energy because you're going to get a lot of blood flow. The alternating hot and cold shower. The recommendation is the at least 3-to-1 ratio. So generally I tell my patients 2 minutes hot, 1 minute, or sorry, not 1 minute, 30 seconds cold. You can make it as cold as you want. I do not care as long as cool, cooler than what you're doing as your comfortable shower, and you're alternating 3 times minimum. The more you do it, the better.
I can't get past the first one.
Most people can. It's actually easier if you do it in a swimming pool. So if you do the cold plunge and then hot tub and then back and forth, it's actually easier with that than actually doing it controlled yourself. Same thing with the counting of the cold, how long you're in the cold water. I don't care how fast you count, really. Just don't skip numbers. Okay, so you're counting to 30 as fast as you can. And then you're hot. The other part is that you actually need to end on cold.
So,
if you end on odd, you actually neutralize the whole effect,
yeah.
And you won't get the full benefit of that. Enemas. Enemas is one of those things where pretty helpful as you try to clean your body out, especially that elimination stage. That I do recommend that's you're seeing someone for it, and yourself. It's super messy, and generally things shouldn't go up that direction usually. but yeah, making sure you do it, coffee enemas is very much the normal that we've seen, but there are a lot of, right? The colon hydrotherapies, there are places around. I know practitioners who do it, they do a great job of it. And that just helps again with that elimination.
So, sorry, you did say coffee enemas?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so coffee enemas is, so people have forgotten over time that coffee in itself is actually not supposed to keep, it's not designed to keep people awake. It's actually used as a digestive, right? That was historically what it was used for. So that's why it's still offered, right? As after meal, a drink, even though at dinner time you probably wouldn't want to drink it, but it's just to help with eliminating at the end of the day. So yes, coffee is very much that.
Does decaf work?
Not the same. The reason is some of the when they take the caffeinated part of it, some of the other things that have been taken out in that decaffeine process is removed as well, so it doesn't have the full effect. Castor oil baths. This has been coming up a little bit more often. Biggest thing is do not take it internally. Please do not take it internally. You can apply it onto your liver directly or just pack. So if you take a cloth and you soak that cloth with a castor oil and apply it directly on your liver and then heat it, the other part is heating it, it will activate it. Your skin will absorb that castor oil path, and it's a nice way to help the liver cleanse some of those toxins. You can do it on your stomach as well, just to help again with some of that movement. It relaxes muscles, so that helps with just movement in itself. You're doing it about for 20 minutes, okay? And please don't do it every day either. That's once a week, maybe depending on case by case basis. But that's one way to do it. Dry skin brushing. So those who do not like alternating hot and cold showers, this is a nice alternative for that. The dry skin brushing is a way to help move that lymphatic system a little bit more. Okay.
Can you explain what that is?
Yeah. So dry skin brushing in itself is you're going to grab a loofah, a towel, and what you're going to do is you're going to rub circles. Everyone can see this. So you're going to rub circles from your outer limbs towards your core. And so you're going from legs to your core, arms to your body, and you're doing it nice and light, and that's key. If you're doing it too deep, you may block out the lymphatic system. Your lymphatic system is very superficial on your body, so you don't want to press too hard, and then you're kind of waiting for your skin to turn up. Now, those who are a little bit darker, you may not want to wait till you spread, because you might be pushing too hard, but that's a nice way of doing that. Dry skin brushing you can do if you want to daily, but I usually recommend 2-3 times a week if you can, but again, if you know.
Can those lymph nodes actually get plugged? Like, will you?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you, again, because of how it, because it carries fat mainly, right? So you think about why do you not pour oil and pass it down the drain, right? Because it's going to clog up the arteries. The lymphatic system's veins are smaller than just even regular blood veins, so they get clogged very, very easily. Yeah. Movement. We want people to move, especially in the last 2 years where we've been kind of stuck at home or on Zoom or whatever the case is. We've done a lot of sitting, and so the idea of moving around, right? We want that flow going, we want that circulation going. So I do recommend that everyone gets up every hour, moving for a minute or two. So not a lot, right? Just to get that blood flowing, get those limbs moving, it helps with a whole lot of the circulation. And then saunas, whether it's infrared, wet, dry, you're going to threat, we're using it, that skin, right? We're using that backup system to eliminate those toxins that are trapped in the body, and you're just sweating it out. So might as well use that to our advantage, that backup system.
Is there a big difference between wet and dry heat? So I always hear there is, but
there is. Depending on the case, wet can dry is actually a little bit. I can't say it's better necessarily, but you're going to get deeper down with that versus just the wet. Wet tends to be more superficial in general.
Oh, okay. I also don't see the way around. Because when you go to physio, they'll put that damp wet pack on you, right? Before they do physio.
That's true.
All right.
Yeah.
I'd have to double check that then.
Okay.
Yeah. And I still believe points. So last one. As mentioned before, so we did talk more about the liver, the kidneys, the lungs, but you can't actually drain and cleanse the nervous system, and that's where the homeopathic remedies come in a little bit more. The herbs generally that have been done usually just more supportive, but yes, we can, and I do quite a bit of this actually, but yes, you can drain the nervous system as well. So anything that has been trapped in the nervous system because of just clogness or the affinities that some of these toxins have for the nervous system, we can help clean that out. The key though, the important part is, and as mentioned before, if your liver, your kidneys, and your lungs are not working properly, and I decide to clean up and you try to clean out your nervous system, it will only go back, right? If you're not eliminating properly, unfortunately, it'll just go back to the nervous system and kind of back to square one, right? So you've got to make sure that those things are opened up first.
Okay.
Always. Thanks for your time. I know I spoke pretty quick. Tend to do that when I get excited. So, So thank you for your time. Any questions?
We do have people asking if we'll be able to send out the slides. Yeah.
James, you mentioned movement. Can you speak more to like exercise and how it would cleanse out the system?
Oh, yeah. So when I say movement, it's not necessarily full on exercising, it's just the walking around, stretching out. Mainly, I ask people to walk more than anything, just kind of pace around as they need at their leisure. And what it is, again, as you walk around and pump that blood around and that circulation, it also pumps up the lymphatic system inadvertently. And so by doing that, then things just kind of move a little bit more around our system. Then it just helps with the liver and the kidneys versus just being stagnant. And then things are just not pumping as well. Because then, yeah, it literally is about the heart pumping and the lungs kind of inhaling and something like that. Yeah.
You had mentioned vitamin A before. So I had seen a naturopath years and years ago, and she told me I had a deficiency. So I've been taking vitamin A, but you said that there you can have too much vitamin A. So now I'm wondering if I should get retested.
I would retest just in case. Again, vitamin A has nasty accumulating, but in all cases, it can be toxic and high levels to the body.
Okay.
When it's stuck. Yeah.
Another question I had was around gluten. So I know a lot of people with peripheral neuropathy, when they're careful with their diet and they cut out anything wheat-based or gluten-based, they really notice a big difference. So is the gluten toxic or is that something else that's going on?
So it's not that so much gluten is toxic, so much that it's inflammatory. And so what happens is gluten itself is just inflammatory to the body. So then you're inflaming your system that much more. So any weak points in your body or any spots are in trouble, the gluten will make it worse, and aggravate that inflammation process. Is why gluten is so, that's why people feel better with gluten.
Okay. Anybody else in the room or online?
It's It was a one time put on the liver transplant list, and I started taking milk thistle, and it really helped me out. So that is a true thing, because it helped rejuvenate my liver, and now I've been taken off the liver transplant list. Thank you.
Okay, well, we got some thank yous, and yeah, more thank yous. So thanks very much.
And from us, you'll get a hand.
With Linda, and she can distribute as necessary.
Okay.
And then the slides, yeah, I'll send, I'll give you this. Well, you have the slides, so.
We haven't given out a thank you gift in 2 years.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for listening, everyone.
Thank you.
It's a great presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, we have a question come in here. Recently saw CBC News that Monsanto is in all our foods.
Yeah.
I don't know if they're okay. I don't think we have an answer for that right now, but okay, so I'm gonna let everybody go. And keep an eye on the website or your mail, and I'll hopefully figure out something for November. But if not, we'll just have to cancel that one. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hopefully, it was just a lot of change.
That's a hint, drink plenty of water.
Yes. Yeah, I would come up with that and actually.